Assalamu alaikum. Gonna give you guys a minute to log on. Inshallah ta'ala, we'll start. We're on Juz 21 today. Assalam. Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalam wa rahmatullah. All right, I think we're at enough viewers now. All right, let's go ahead and start. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulihi al-kareem. وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Alhamdulillah, I'm much better today. Thank you guys for asking. Coming along quite well now, alhamdulillah. Hopefully, inshallah ta'ala, one more day and I'll be completely done with this this interesting throat infection that struck me in Ramadan. So first of all, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept your ibadat last night, your acts of worship last night, and all of your acts of worship in these last 10 nights. We're in the last third of the month, and we're in the last third of the Qur'an as well. As a result of that, we've now made it to Juz 21. And Juz 21, you know, subhanAllah, last Juz we talked a lot about tests and trials and tribulations on a very personal level. The idea that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test you, and you need to be prepared for that. You need to expect those tests to come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those trials to come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And, you know, you need to embrace them and do as you've been commanded to do as you face those various trials in life. Sūrah Luqmān sort of starts off with that tone, and it reminds us that, look, people that were better than you were tested. People like Musa alayhi salam, people like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were tested. So you should expect to be tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in some capacity. But at the end of the day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to see you through that test, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to pass that test. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions to us people that take refuge in things other than Him. The key point here that was emphasized in the previous juz that really connects to this next juz, Juz 21, is that your refuge should be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your refuge should be God when you are tested. La malja'a wa la manja'a minka illa ilayk. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to say, there's no shelter or refuge from you except to you. So when we're tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we run back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, you know, Surah Al-Ankabut started off with, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا أَمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Do people think that they just say we believe and they're not going to be tested? And Allah warns us of falling prey to the shaytan and to his tricks when we're in those moments of vulnerability. The second half of Surah Al-Ankabut, which is the beginning of Juz 21, the beginning of the next Juz, it mentions to us, first of all, the reason why the surah was named Al-Ankabut, which literally means the spider. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ كَمَثَلِ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ اتَّخَذَتْ بَيْتًا وَإِنَّ أَوْهَنَ الْبُيُوتِ لَبَيْتُ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the example of those who take protectors and gods beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like the spider. It builds its home, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and the flimsiest of homes is the spider web, is the home of the spider. If only we would reflect, if only we had knowledge and we'd pay attention. SubhanAllah, this is such a powerful representation of the home of the spider. Why? Because a spider web, you know, obviously you could blow on it, it comes apart, you know, with water, with wind. It's a very flimsy home. But at the same time, those that are caught within a spider's web are caught very heavily. So the inside tensile strength of a spider web is stronger than steel, which is why if you see mosquitoes caught inside spider webs, they're not getting out. But the spider web itself is weak. Now, subhanAllah, what Allah is telling us here is that people take protectors and allies beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They take protection and refuge in things other than God. And those things are not going to offer them the protection that they want. They're not going to offer them the comfort that they want. They're not going to offer them the happiness that they want. Sometimes we take refuge in our own strength. Sometimes we take refuge in our own competence and our own intelligence. Sometimes we take refuge in our alliances and our positions in society, in our wealth. Sometimes we take refuge in our nationality or, you know, in whatever it may be. The point is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will break that, and it's flimsy. Sometimes we take refuge in our haram relationships, and when you're in that haram relationship, you can't see outside of it, right? You think that you need this relationship to succeed and to thrive in life. But then something happens and suddenly you realize that that relationship was flimsy. So the point being here that do not put your trust in anything besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and do not seek refuge in anything but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And those that are caught up in these fantasies of protection and strength and invincibility, it's only a matter of time before that spider web is completely blown away by some wind or some rain or whatever it may be. So it's only a matter of time before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exposes the weakness of the thing that you seek, that you sought refuge in. In the last ayah of Surah Al-Ankabut, so this is actually going to tie very well to the next two surahs. So I want you to imagine again the spider's web. The point is, take refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your source of strength is Allah. Your source of protection is Allah. In the last verse of Surah Al-Ankabut, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and those who strive in our path, we will surely guide them to our paths. Those who strive in our way, we will surely open the doors for them, and we will guide them to our paths. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with the doers of good. Allah is always with the muhsineen. This is a very powerful ayah, because if you, in the beginning of Surah Al-Ankabut, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that those who strive, فَإِنَّمَا يُجَاهِدُ لِنَفْسِهِ, that they strive for their own good. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَغَنِيٌّ عَنِ الْعَالَمِينَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is independent of need, and Allah doesn't need your righteousness. You're seeking Allah's pleasure and favor, and you're seeking protection on Allah and seeking refuge in Allah is for your own good. Allah doesn't need any one of us to do that. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and those who strive in our way though, we will open the doors for them. We will guide them to our paths. And indeed, Allah is with the doer of good. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with the muhsin. Allah is with a person who tries to excel and seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's pleasure. That's on a community basis and on an individual level. Inna Allaha lama'al muhsinin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with the muhsinin. What that tells us, that is that when a person or when a community is collectively showing ihsan, collectively showing excellence, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant them goodness, and Allah will see them through their difficulties. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will allow them to overcome any type of hardship that they face as a community. On an individual level, when you're with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will see you through your difficulty. So whether you are muhsineen as a group of people, whether you are people who excel as a group, or whether you are someone who excels as an individual, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be with you when you're in a state of ihsan. Why is this so powerful? Because the next two surahs literally prove this last ayah. The next two surahs focus on this last ayah, the concept that's highlighted in this last ayah, as well as, you know, the idea that a person who seeks refuge in anything but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will soon have their home shattered in that sense, right? Their place of refuge will prove to be flimsy. So the next surah is Surah Ar-Rum, which literally means Rome. And Surah Ar-Rum, the background of it, the context of it, is that you had at the time of, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the advent of Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam receiving revelation, and the Muslims undergoing persecution in Mecca, you had two superpowers in the region, and arguably in the world, really, the Romans and the Persians. The Muslims identified themselves with the Romans because the Romans were Christians, they were monotheists. The pagans of Mecca identified with the pagans of Persia, right? The Persians were constantly oppressing, were constantly defeating the Romans in battle. So in this particular era, you know, the Romans were constantly being overcome by the Persians. And, you know, the cross, in fact, the true cross, which is, you know, in Christianity is the cross that Isa, Islam, Jesus, peace be upon him, was crucified upon. That cross was confiscated from Jerusalem. It was taken to Persia. Jerusalem was in ruins. The Romans were completely being defeated and demolished and annihilated by the Persians. The Muslims felt, again, an affinity towards the Christians. Part of that reason is, of course, Abyssinia. Najashi in Abyssinia and what he did for the Muslims there when he took them in, the Christian king of Abyssinia. What was happening in Mecca is that the Quraysh were basically telling the Muslims that just like the Persians are constantly crushing the Romans, we are going to constantly crush you. That just like the Christians are being destroyed by the Majus, you will be destroyed as well. And so they're watching this conflict play out around them, and there's a great sense of arrogance in the people of Mecca, right? In the pagans of Mecca, a sense of invincibility, just like the Persians had a sense of invincibility. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts off Surah Ar-Rūm, Alif Lam Mim, Ghulibatir Rum, Fi Adna Al-Ardi, Wahum Min Ba'di Ghalabihim, Sayaghlibun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that verily the Romans have been defeated, the Byzantines have been defeated. Fi Adna Al-Ard. وَهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ غَلَبِهِمْ سَيَغْلِبُونَ in the lowest point on earth. Now, أَدْنَى الْأَرْضِ can mean the nearest land to you, so it can mean, it can be referring to the land close to you, or it could be referring to أَدْنَى الْأَرْضِ in the literal sense, the lowest point on earth. Some of the scholars mentioned that this victory of the Persians over the Romans had just taken place in the area of the Dead Sea. And the area of the Dead Sea is indeed the lowest point on earth. So it's, some of the scholars mentioned this as a miracle of the Qur'an. But the point is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that the Persians have just dealt the Romans a crippling defeat. But Allah says, وَهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ غَلَبِهِمْ سَيَغْلِبُونَ But after the Romans have been defeated, they will come back and they will defeat the Persians. Right? Now this was an audacious claim at the time. And you know, if the Prophet ﷺ was a fabricator, this was... You know, and of course he was not, but if you were to accuse the Prophet ﷺ of being a fabricator, then this is a very dangerous claim to make, to choose literally the underdog and to say that they are going to win, that they're actually going to be victorious over the Persians. Not only that, but to give a time frame, fi bidla'i sinin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that within 3 to 9 years, he specified, bidla' is 3 to 9 years. Between 3 and 9 years, the Romans will defeat the Persians. لِلَّهِ الْأَمْرُ مِنْ قَبْلِ وَمِنْ بَعْدِ وَيَوْمَ إِذٍ يَفْرَحُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ بِنَصْرِ اللَّهِ يَنْصُرُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الرَّحِيمُ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah is in control. The decision belongs to Allah before and after. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in control this entire time, whether the Romans are being defeated or the Persians are being defeated. And on that day, the believers will rejoice. The Muslims will rejoice at the victory given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the Romans against the Persians. Why? Because the believers would see that as a sign that they also would attain victory. Binasrillah, with the help of Allah, He helps whom He wills. Wa huwa al-aziz al-rahim, and He is the Almighty and the Most Merciful. Wa'adallahi la yukhlifu Allahu wa'ada, walakinna akthara an-nasi la ya'lamun. It is a promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not fail in His promise, but most people know not. Most people don't pay attention. And listen to this, subhanAllah, this is so powerful. يَعْلَمُونَ ظَاهِرًا مِنَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ عَنِ الْآخِرَةِ هُمْ غَافِلُونَ The only thing they see is the surface level of the life of this world. They pay attention to the outside appearance of the life of this world, and they are completely heedless of the life of the hereafter, the eternal life afterwards. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to us is that we always see things literally at surface level. And this is something that Allah alluded to in the previous juz as well. How can we make judgment on the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if we're only seeing such a limited scope of the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala play out in front of us? We see a very surface level of the world around us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always in charge, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guaranteed the believers a victory. Now, subhanAllah, this is interesting because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave, you know, so 3 to 9 years, right? The Romans were being defeated 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 6 years, 7 years, 8 years. So the Persians kept on defeating the Romans, and there was a sense of, you know, okay, what's going to happen here? The Quran made a prediction here. It prophesies the victory of the Romans over the Persians. SubhanAllah, after 8.5 years, because Allah said 3 to 9 years, after 8.5 years, the Romans overcame the Persians. In the same year, In the same year, 624, the Muslims defeated the people of Mecca in the Battle of Badr. SubhanAllah, so in both years, the underdogs won. The Christians won and the Muslims won, right? The Romans defeated the Persians and the Muslims defeated the Mushrikeen in the year 624 in the Battle of Badr. So this had a double meaning to it, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would give victory to the believers and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would see them through this difficulty. Now, what does this relate to the previous juz and the previous messaging in Surah Al-Ankabut? Number one, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned these people that believed in their own strength and in their own capability and that thought that they were invincible. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَوَلَمْ يَتَفَكَّرُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ. Don't you think about the way that you were created? Contemplate within yourselves. مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ وَأَجَلٍ مُسَمَّى وَإِنَّ كَثِيرًا مِنَ النَّاسِ بِلِقَاءِ رَبِّهِمْ لَكَافِرُونَ أَوَلَمْ يَسِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فَيَنْظُرُوا كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ كَانُوا أَشَدَّ مِنْهُمْ قُوَّةً وَأَثَارُوا الْأَرْضَ وَعَمَرُوهَا أَكْثَرَ مِمَّا عَمَرُوهَا وَجَاءَتْهُمْ رُسُلُهُمْ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ فَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيَظْلِمَهُمْ وَلَكِنْ كَانُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ يَظْلِمُونَ. This is verse 9. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Ar-Rūm, you know, don't they look to the creation of the heavens and the earth? Haven't they traveled through the earth and observed how was the end of those that came before them? People that were greater than them in power, people that plowed the earth and that built up more than what they have built up, and their messengers came to them with evidences and proofs, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not wrong them, but they wronged themselves. The point is, people that became too arrogant because of their strength, because of their power. Power is intoxicating. We see it all the time. Absolute power absolutely corrupts, right? We see it with dictators, the illusion of power, the illusion of invincibility. An oppressor, in whatever capacity they are in, is intoxicated by their own sense of power or their own fantasy of power. Whether it's an oppressor in the house or an oppressor at a statewide, you know, a state level, or an oppressor at a country level, whatever it may be, an oppressor is under the intoxication and the illusion and fantasy of invincibility and power, and it's only a matter of time before Allah shatters that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about these people that take, you know, that are within these spider webs, right? That are caught up in their own illusions. And at the end of Surah Al-Ankabut, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with the muhsineen. He's with people of excellence. He's with the good doers. And Surah Ar-Rum shows us that. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us how He saw the believers through their difficult time and gave them victory and was with them. Because of their ihsan, because of their excellence, and because of their connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. one more thing in Surah Ar-Rum, before we move into Surah Luqman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a very beautiful discourse about His power. So in verse 17, فَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ حِينَ تُمْسُونَ وَحِينَ تُصْبِحُونَ وَلَهُ الْحَمْدُ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَعَشِيًّا وَحِينَ تُظْهِرُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so glorify Allah above all that they associate with Him when you come to the evening and when you enter into the morning. And to Him belongs all praises and thanks in the heavens and the earth. And glorify Him in the afternoon and when you come up to the time, when the day begins to decline. So basically, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu says that these two ayat actually give us the five daily prayers, the times of the five daily prayers. And Allah says, يُخْرِجُ الْحَيَّ مِنَ الْمَيِّتِ وَيُخْرِجُ الْمَيِّتَ مِنَ الْحَيِّ وَيُحْيِي الْأَرْضَ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا وَكَذَلِكَ تُخْرَجُونَ. In verse 19, He brings out the living from the dead, and He brings out the dead from the living, and He revives the earth after its death, and thus you shall be resurrected. Now, the next discourse, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ. Allah mentions His signs. What are the signs of Allah's greatness and Allah's power? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned to us, يَعْلَمُونَ ظَاهِرًا مِنَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. All we pay attention to, or all we're able to see, is the surface level of this world, right? The observable universe, the observable dunya. Allah has created us with that limitation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now points to the signs. What are the signs that there is this all-powerful creator, that there is this Rabb, this Lord, that is in charge, the sustainer that's in charge of all of our affairs. So Allah says, what you can see, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ, from His signs, أَنْ خَلَقَكُمْ مِنْ تُرَابٍ ثُمَّ إِذَا أَنْتُمْ بَشَرٌ تَنْتَشِرُونَ. That Allah created you from dirt, And then behold, here you are, human beings scattered throughout the earth. So look at your existence as a proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعْلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. And among his signs, this is the verse of the Qur'an that's on the wedding invitations and that's recited before people start partying at their weddings, right? So from his signs is that he created for you spouses from amongst yourselves that you may find comfort in them. And he has put between you affection and mercy. Verily in that are signs for people who reflect. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ خَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافُ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And from his signs is the creation of the heavens and the earth and the diversity of your language and your languages and your colors. Indeed, in that are signs for those of knowledge, for people of knowledge. The sophistication, subhanAllah, of our creation, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. He created us in different ways. He created for us mates. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala diversified our languages. He diversified our skin colors. And subhanAllah, as I've said in a separate posting, it's amazing that the verse about marriage, which is verse 21, the verse of Allah creating for you mates, is sandwiched between two ayat that condemn racism. SubhanAllah. That condemn a sense of nationalism and racism. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ مَنَامُكُمْ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ وَابْتِغَاؤُكُمْ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَسْمَعُونَ. And among his signs is your sleep by night and day, and your seeking of his bounty. Indeed, in that are signs for people who listen. So in your weakness, in your vulnerability, whether you like it or not, you need sleep, right? And you seek the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the day. And indeed, in that are signs for people who listen, who heed the reminder. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ يُرِيكُمُ الْبَرْقَ خَوْفًا وَطَمَعًا وَيُنَزِّلُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً فَيُحْيِي بِهِ الْأَرْضَ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَعْقِلُونَ. And among his signs is that he shows you the lightning by way of fear and hope. When you see the lightning, it depends on your situation if you're going to have fear or hope. How strong is the lightning? Is a tornado going to come out of this? Is the wind going to be beneficial or is it going to be a destructive wind? Is the rain going to be beneficial or is it going to be a destructive rain? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends rain as a reward and Allah sends it as a punishment. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends it as a test, right? But the point is that you have no idea what to expect. This is a proof of your inability to plan and to understand the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you don't know as the world, as the lightning starts, or as the rain starts, or as the wind starts, you don't know what's coming out of it. And indeed, in that are signs for people who use reason. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَن تَقُومَ السَّمَاءُ وَالْأَرْضُ بِأَمْرِهِ ثُمَّ إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ دَعْوَةً مِنَ الْأَرْضِ إِذَا أَنْتُمْ تُخْرَجُونَ. And among his signs is that the heaven and the earth will stand by his command. Then afterwards, Allah will call you with a single call. And behold, you will come out from the earth, from your graves, for your reckoning and for your account. SubhanAllah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling us to his power and to observe in the signs around us and in the signs within ourselves, in our strengths and in our weaknesses, in what's predictable of the earth around us and what's unpredictable. All of that is our signs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in charge and that we are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and completely dependent on him, and that we do not become arrogant, right? Now, I said that Surah Al-Ankabut basically establishes that you should put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should seek refuge in Allah, and if you're with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see you through your difficulties. Don't be intoxicated by your sense of power, by your sense of reason, by your sense of whatever it may be. Seek refuge only in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, otherwise you're living in a spider's web. So in Surah Ar-Rūm, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us an observable example that he gave victory to the people of Badr, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave victory to the Romans over the Persians, even though the Persians thought they were invincible due to their strength and power, and the Meccans thought they were invincible due to their strength and power. Allah is condemning here arrogance on a community level. As we said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ, Allah is with the good doers, is on a community level and on an individual level. The next surah is Sūrah Luqmān. Sūrah Luqmān. Luqman al-Hakim alayhi salam, the wise sage that was known to the people of Mecca, a freed Abyssinian slave that lived around the time of Dawood alayhi salam, who was known for his wisdom, And he was known for his amthad, for his parables, and for his wisdom, and for his sayings. And the people of Mecca had him as a legend of sorts, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala points out about Luqman al-Hakim alayhi salam that he was a man of tawheed, that he was a man of monotheism. And Allah gives us, of course, in Surah Luqman, the advice of Luqman al-Hakim to his son. So Allah tells us to be humble, and that humility brings about victory on a community level and on an individual level. Be humble, recognize that your power, your strength, your capability comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and do not be amongst those who transgress. So Allah mentions to us now the personal discussion, the personal conversation between Luqman and his son. وَإِذْ قَالَ لُقْمَانُ لِبْنِهِ وَهُوَ يَعِذُهُ يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. When Luqman said to his son while he was giving him advice, "Oh my dear son, do not associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Indeed, associating a partner with him is a great injustice." وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ وَفِصَالُهُ فِي عَامَيْنِ أَنِ اشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيْكَ إِلَيَّ الْوَصِيرُ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so this is verse 13, now 14 of Surah Luqman. Allah says, "And we've enjoined upon man to care for his parents. His mother carried him in weakness, and you know, and as the time went on, it only gave her more weakness. Meaning, his mother had to bear him in pain, and his weaning is within 2 years. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Be grateful to me and to your parents. To me is the final destination." So, in the first two verses or the first two advices of Luqman to his son, you know, be good to that. Recognize the right that your Lord has upon you, and recognize the right that your parents have upon you. وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and if they strive to make you join in worship with me, others that of which you have no knowledge. So if your parents tell you to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then don't obey them, but behave with them with absolute kindness. Show them excellence and kindness. Even if they're telling you to commit shirk, even if they're telling you to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, still show them your kindness and show them your love, and follow the path of him who turns to me in repentance and in obedience. Then to me will be your return, and I shall inform you of that which you used to do. Ya bunayya, O my son, innaha intaku mithqala habbatin min khardalin fatakun fi sakhratin aw fi samawati aw fil ard. يَأْتِ بِهَا اللَّهُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَطِيفٌ خَبِيرٌ. O my son, even if indeed, if a sin, if wrong, should be in the weight of a mustard seed, and if it was hidden in a rock anywhere in the heavens and the earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring it forth. Indeed, Allah is ever subtle, yet ever acquainted. This is a message to us, that a lot of times we feel like we can get away with our sins. A lot of times we feel like we can hide our sins. And even if we can hide our sins from people and not face the consequences of those sins in this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring it forth. Don't feel like you can fool Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't feel like you can operate in this world without being seen and observed by your Lord. So recognize that Allah is watching you, and recognize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will produce your record forward. Ya bunayya, aqim as-salah, wa'mur bil ma'ruf. Actually, subhanAllah, I want to end with this, or not end with this, but at the end of this ayah, Allah is ever subtle, yet he's ever acquainted. This is a beautiful piece of the previous two surahs, and actually Surah Al-Qasas as well, that though Allah may be subtle in the way that he carries out the affairs of this world, Allah is never unacquainted. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with the believers, he's with the muhsineen, and Allah is always acquainted and very well aware, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always acquainted and well aware in this world and in the next. Oh my dear son, أقم الصلاة, establish your prayer, وأمر بالمعروف, and enjoin that which is good, وانهى عن المنكر, and forbid that which is evil, واصبر على ما أصابك, and be patient with that which is going to strike you in this world, إن ذلك من عزم الأمور, and that is of the most difficult things to observe. It's one of the most important commandments, but it requires a lot of determination. Surah Al-Ankabut focuses on the tests and the trials that we face in this world, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us to be patient. Here Luqman is telling his son, continue to enjoin your prayers. Don't leave your prayers. And don't stop doing good and forbidding evil. And be patient when hardship comes to you, inevitably comes to you. And that is from the things that require the greatest determination. وَلَا تُصَاعِرْ حَدَّكَ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَمْشِي فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحًا. And do not turn your face away from men with pride, nor walk through the earth with arrogance. Verily, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not love every مُخْتَالٍ فَخُورٍ, every self-deluded and boastful person. Meaning, don't ever get full of yourself. Don't ever get a big head. Realize that you're still in the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So don't show arrogance in the way that you turn your faces towards the people. Don't turn your nose upwards to the people, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could humble you quickly. And do not walk in the earth arrogantly, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could take you away in a moment. And Allah does not like an arrogant, boastful person. وَقْصِدْ فِي مَشْيِكَ وَغْضُضْ مِنْ صَوْتِكَ. And be moderate in the way that you walk, and speak with a low voice. Don't speak arrogantly. Don't walk arrogantly. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Luqman alayhi salam says to his son, إِنَّ أَنْكَرَ الْأَصْوَاتِ لَصَوْتُ الْحَمِيرِ, that the harshest of all voices is the braying of the donkey. You know, don't bray like a donkey when you raise your voice and speak with insolence and speak with a sense of pride. Humble yourself. Realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in charge. Realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is your source of strength and your source of power and your source of ability. Realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is well aware of that which you do. Realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could change your fortune in a moment. Realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with the muhsineen on a community level and on an individual level. Allah is with the good doers. So Surah Al-Ankabut establishes that there are people that take false refuge in things that will not benefit them or protect them. Surah Ar-Rūm shows us a community that's destroyed because they felt invincible due to their strength. A community that's given victory because they were muhsineen. Sūrah Luqmān gives us the advice of a father to a son to be humble in the way that you carry yourself in this life, to be patient, to be aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be with you if you are a person of ihsan, if you are a person of excellence. So that brings us to the end of Juz 21. What I'm going to do, since it's the last 10 nights inshallah ta'ala, every single day I'm going to mention a charity that's close to my heart, hoping that you all will donate to that charity, hoping that you all will support that charity. So it's the last 10 days, inshallah, the last 10 nights. So make sure that you give charity every single night, inshallah ta'ala, even if it's something very small. So tonight I want to actually mention, or today, I want to mention the charity, which is Muhsin. We were talking about al-Muhsineen, people of good doers, people who excel. And if someone could do the honor of posting the link, inshallah ta'ala, to the to Muhsin, in the comments, inshallah. I'll do it as soon as I finish this broadcast. But Muhsin stands for Muslims Understanding and Helping with Special Education Needs. It's a very, very beautiful charity, one that is a game changer in the Muslim community. It's a charity that seeks to make our masajid more accommodating to people with disabilities and to families who have members in their families that have disabilities. It has a masjid certification program. We had the largest group, mashallah, that marched in the National Autism March this year at Soldier Field in Chicago. And it's, you know, we provide a wide range of services for people with disabilities, and it's a charity that's very near and dear to my heart. So every day, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to mention to you a charity, and I hope that all of you will rush to give, inshallah ta'ala, to that. So again, since we were talking about Muhsineen today, our first charity today is Muhsin, inshallah. Jazakumullahu khairan to you all, inshallah ta'ala. I will see you tomorrow. Wassalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.